Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Age of Scientific Wellness. Why the future of medicine is personalized, predictive, data-rich, and in your hands. By Leroy Hood, MD, PhD, and Nathan Price, PhD. Narrated by Jonathan Todd Ross. Introduction. This is a book about the future. It's about the promises, pitfalls, and challenges we will have to overcome if we want to take the next big leap in human health. Not everyday progress that comes incrementally, but exponential improvement in the human condition. Our deeply held belief, which has emerged from our personal and scientific experiences, is that we are in the first stage of the largest paradigm shift in healthcare since the beginning of modern medicine, a time when the fundamental ways in which we approach health will change so profoundly that we will struggle to understand why we ever did things any other way. Soon we will be able to track and optimize the health trajectory of every individual throughout their life. We will be able to keep their bodies healthy and their minds young much longer than we do now. New technologies will make it possible to vastly improve the well-being of every person on this planet. Yes, every person, for we should consider wellness to be a fundamental human right and strive to share these benefits broadly. This admittedly bold vision begins with a dismantling of our contemporary medical paradigm, a model that is really sick care rather than health care. In today's world, medical interventions happen long after a disease has taken hold, following a centuries-old medical playbook that goes like this. 1. Wait for something to go wrong. 2. Try to identify what caused the problem. 3. Try to fix it. 4. If it works, try the same approach on the next person. 5. If it doesn't work, treat the complications, or write a death certificate and move along. Even when the current model for care does work, significant damage has been done. We have long known that people who contract one disease are more likely to become sick with another. Diabetes increases the risk for dementia and coronary artery disease. Cancer increases the risk of pulmonary thromboembolism. And so it goes. It is true that risk factors for any one disease are potential starting places for many others. But there is another reality that physicians and researchers are beginning to recognize. Our body is a system of systems, in which the perturbations caused by disease in one place can lead to seemingly unrelated problems in other places. It does us little good to view the human body in binary terms as either well, in which case medical care is unnecessary, or sick, in which case it is. Yet this is how our healthcare systems are built, not just in the United States, but around the world. But there is a whole spectrum to wellness, and a long trajectory in the progression of disease to end-stage illness. This book offers an alternative, a vision of 21st century medicine that might meet and prevail over the vast medical challenges of our time. This vision begins with the dismantling of our current binary framing of wellness and disease in favor of the more nuanced, more accurate, and more commonsensical notion that each person's state of health exists on a spectrum across wellness, transition, and disease. It should go without saying that the healthcare of the future will seek to optimize the amount of time that we are well. Yet contemporary medicine does very little in this regard. Most of us, as a result, are less healthy than we think. It is likely, in fact, that the physical and mental youthfulness, vigor, and resiliency that represent the wellness phase often only exists through the first 10 to 15 years of most people's adult lives. Perhaps as little as 20% of their adult lifespan. If you are older than your 20s, It is very likely that you have already slipped out of a state of wellness and are in a phase of transition to disease and aging-associated declines. This phase can occupy a large portion of our lives, and yet it is all but completely ignored in the current healthcare paradigm. In fairness, this is partially because it has long been almost impossible to see these early wellness to disease transitions clearly. Soon, however, we will have the capacity to identify these transitions and safely intervene, reversing the movement toward disease and returning individuals to outright wellness. We will be able to do this again and again throughout the course of a person's life. We, Lee and Nathan, are both optimists, but we do not foresee a future in which we beat back all diseases altogether and forever. If and when a transition to fatal disease does happen, it should come swiftly and as painlessly as possible, capping a full, productive, healthy, and happy life of overwhelming wellness. So, how do we get there? Wellness, transition, and disease. Our current health trajectories feature an early period of wellness, followed by mostly imperceptible transitions, leading to the onset of diseases in the middle of life. More than 1 in 4 adults in the United States has at least one diagnosable chronic condition by the age of 44, and about 2/3 will be diagnosed with a chronic disease by the time they reach the age of 65. So it is that many of us spend half or more of our lives in a state of disease, whether we know it or not. The idea that drives our new paradigm is to optimize each phase of the human health trajectory, lengthening periods of wellness and improving its quality, detecting and reversing transitions at the earliest possible moments, and greatly delaying, if not altogether avoiding, disease. We will do this through a data-driven process we call scientific wellness, an approach that will extend the wellness phase from the 20s to the 80s, and eventually beyond. There are 3 categories of information we need for every person to implement this data-driven vision of wellness and prevention. The first is the genome, the source code of life, which is virtually invariant throughout a person's lifetime, save for the case of the mutations in cancer cells. Despite major advances in genomic analysis that have brought down the cost and time it takes to sequence an individual's genome, fewer than 0.01% of the people on this planet have had their entire genome sequenced. Even though this only has to be done once, it's a first hurdle on the path to data-driven health. Thankfully, this is now simple to do through numerous affordable commercial offerings, and hopefully soon will be a routine part of healthcare. The second is the phenome, an assessment of your body's status at any point in time during your life as a result of the interaction of your genome, your lifestyle, and your environment. Your phenome changes continuously, and it can be sampled at any time through certain measurements, such as the gut microbiome and blood analytes, which are the proteins, metabolites, and other molecules that move through your body and mediate many of life's functions, including energy production, nutrition, and cognition. Because the phenome is constantly changing, it needs to be sampled far more often than the genome, ideally several times a year, and this is a rather big second hurdle. The third category is digital measurements of health. This might be the easiest of the three, as there are already hundreds of millions of people worldwide collecting this kind of data on themselves, most often through the use of smartphones, watches, smart rings, and other wearables that can track their heart rate, body temperature, respiration, activity level, calories consumed and burned, sleep, menstrual cycles, blood sugar, hormone balances, and more. With these 3 categories of data in hand, we can begin to assess the optimal physiology of one's body and brain, and detect early transitory phases many years, even decades, before a disease becomes clinically apparent. With this sort of lead time and a positive focus on optimizing health and resilience, we can use these same data to design and target personalized therapies that will end the transition long before disease materializes, when the pathological changes at hand are less complex and more reversible through interventions that are simpler, safer, and less intrusive. You may have heard aspects of this bandied about in the past by medical practitioners who have suggested that early detection is a panacea for all that ails us. But as most physicians will attest, the pitch has always been better than the product, partly because such strategies are aimed at catching symptoms of disease, not signals of the early wellness to disease transitions. We have been trying to stop wildfires by watching for smoke on the horizon. But when there is smoke, there is already fire. If we get this right, and we cannot overstress how strongly we believe that we can, we will be able to intervene long before the blaze begins. One's health trajectory will become a series of wellness phases punctuated by short transitions, immediately reversed, that will eventually be imperceptible from their general state of robustly good health. For the vast majority of our lives, we will be well beings. Scientific wellness will ultimately allow us to conquer heart disease, the number one killer in America today. It will make it possible to eliminate or vastly reduce incidence of diabetes or rheumatoid arthritis. It will be our ally in the so-called war on cancer. It will make the scourge of Alzheimer's disease a distant memory. This may seem far-fetched, but we are on the cusp of a time when we will have the capacity to begin to eliminate most chronic diseases, though doing so will depend in part on people making choices in their own lives that will keep them well. Let us be candid about how we see this revolution impacting future pandemic threats. Infectious diseases are almost always more dangerous, and in many cases exponentially deadlier, for individuals with pre-existing chronic conditions. This was the case with COVID-19, which sometimes killed indiscriminately, but far more often took the lives of those who already had one or more chronic diseases, whether or not they had been formally diagnosed. So scientific wellness will also be key to fighting the infectious diseases that will be an inevitable part of our future. What would rapid and effective early diagnosis have meant for the deadly coronavirus pandemic? It might have saved hundreds of thousands of lives. COVID-19 was most lethal to those who already had one or more pre-existing conditions, such as cardiovascular disease, chronic kidney disease, chronic lung diseases, diabetes, hypertension, obesity, and autoimmune diseases like rheumatoid arthritis and lupus. In the United States, older Americans represented about a third of the early cases, but they accounted for about half of intensive care admissions and more than three-quarters of deaths. Pre-existing conditions exacerbated the death toll. As the coronavirus pandemic overwhelmed healthcare systems around the world, patients who might have been saved with relatively basic critical care, the nearly 100-year-old technology known as a ventilator, were sometimes left to fend for themselves. There are no words to adequately describe the depth of this global tragedy. Yet it could have been ameliorated by earlier diagnoses and a better understanding of the possible disease trajectories. If some of those pre-existing conditions had been addressed in the earliest stages of the wellness to disease process, how many lives could have been saved? Among those who eventually recovered, the path to health could have been so much smoother, and the draconian measures taken by much of the world largely avoided. When it comes to infectious diseases, the best public health strategy is the one that will finally make a difference in the fight against chronic disease. This strategy is not just to be proactive by a matter of weeks or months. It is to be proactive by years and decades. A healthier population without pre-existing conditions is a population that will be less susceptible to the next pandemic, and the one after that and the one after that. We, of course, collectively know that health is important, but until COVID-19, few viewed healthy sleep, exercise, and diet as active and pressing strategies to survive or minimize disease. One has only to look at the drastically slower progression of the SARS-CoV-2 virus in Japan, where diabetes is almost non-existent and hypertension and obesity are so much lower than in the United States. This is just the beginning of what scientific wellness informed by longitudinal data clouds promises: to detect the earliest wellness to disease transitions and, hopefully, reverse them at their earliest detectable stage. Wellness-centered healthcare throughout life is key to achieving these goals. These bold proclamations come with some caveats. This future will not be realized if we follow a centuries-old strategy of seeking cures that are good for only some people some of the time. Few people realize it, but the 10 most popular drugs in the United States today, from esomeprazole and rosuvastatin to fluticasone and pegfilgrastatin, work collectively for only about 10% of treated patients. Too many people are being subjected to their known side effects without benefit to their underlying condition. We will also fail to realize our goals if we ignore brain health, as is largely the case in contemporary medicine. A larger and larger share of the population is reaching the 9th and 10th decades of life, but often in such a state of mental frailty that these extra years are more of a burden than a blessing. This future will also fail to come about if we continue to treat sickness with the blunt force that even non-invasive treatments and therapies wield against disease. The side effects of medications and consequences of many procedures are often described by patients as a cure worse than the disease. And we will not realize this future if we stubbornly cling to the time-worn idea that a person's chronological age is a suitable stand-in for assessing their state of biological aging. A hard-to-shake notion, even though it is so patently clear that not everyone ages at the same rate. Once we dismantle these four damaging myths about human health, we can embrace a new standard for medical care that uses each person's genetic profile and phenomic measurements to generate a unique list of actionable possibilities. In most cases, these proactive behaviors, verified by clinical studies, will either optimize wellness or prevent or forestall wellness to disease transitions in the body and brain. When a transition does occur, global, holistic, and data-driven approaches to this disease would inform a precise medical response, using massive data analysis to provide fundamental insights into how to approach therapy effectively for each individual. All of this will offer the enticing opportunity for each of us to feel confident that our health spans, the years spent living in wellness without disease, will better align to our lifespans. Ultimately, a lifespan and a health span should be virtually the same, meaning individuals would be able to live into their 90s or longer, maintaining an effective state of mental and physical wellness throughout these years. This may sound like science fiction, but it is not a vision for some distant future. While it will obviously take time to change mainstream medicine, and every one of us will have to participate in our own health journey, we fully believe that the primary actions that must be taken to realize this goal can be completed in the next 15 to 20 years. Indeed, many doctors and scientists are already taking meaningful steps toward applying the principles of scientific wellness to patient care and biomedical research, including the recent rapid growth of clinics dedicated to personalized medicine, functional medicine, integrative medicine, or healthy aging. They are embracing data from the major determinants of each person's health, their genome, their lifestyle, and their exposures to the environment, to build a kind of care that is predictive, preventative, personalized, and participatory, what Lee was the first to call P4 medicine. And they are finding solutions for the major challenges of contemporary medicine: poor quality, exploding costs, the rapid aging of the patient population, and the dramatic increases in the number of individuals with one or more chronic diseases. We will dive into some of these challenges throughout this book. Our goal is to help you see the power of scientific wellness, understand what it will take to build on nascent successes, and optimize your own individual health to ensure a long, productive, and healthy life. In fact, we suspect that what you learn in these chapters will fundamentally change your view of what is possible for your own health. Our hope is that it will also help you see this way of thinking about health not simply as something that you can benefit from, but as a structure for healthcare that can benefit everyone. Getting to that point requires that we recall that medicine is about people. It's about patients and physicians. It's about researchers, healthcare administrators, and coverage providers. The current healthcare paradigm treats these as competing interest groups, but scientific wellness offers us an opportunity to focus everyone's interests toward a new and mutually beneficial goal: a new standard of personalized medicine built for the 21st century and beyond. We will not tell you that we can immediately shake the foundations of global healthcare and get everything right. We will not pretend that disruptive innovation is not going to be disruptive. That would be foolish. Where we see challenges ahead, we will name them and offer possible solutions. When we do not yet know the solutions, we will say so. It will be difficult. If it weren't, it wouldn't be revolutionary. Both of us are actively participating in processes that will bring this vision to pass, and we both believe we'll be around when it comes. For Lee, who is now in his mid-80s, it might seem like a wistful fantasy, but we can see it coming faster and faster, just over the horizon. To understand our confidence, perhaps it would be helpful to say a bit about the past. We wrote this book together, and before we turn to the medical breakthroughs of the last 10 years and what is coming next, we will share a bit about how we got here. For Lee, it all started a long time ago in the small town of Shelby, Montana, 30 miles south of the Canadian border. Lee's story: A Life in Science. There is a preconception that small rural towns are poor places for children to grow up if they want to formulate big, world-changing ideas. The information revolution, which made it possible for anyone anywhere to access endless information, should have put this idea to rest a long time ago. But from my experience, it was never true to begin with. While I think a lot about the future, I am not immune to the nostalgia that is common to people my age. My thoughts often turn to my grandfather's ranch in the shade of the Beartooth Mountains, and to the town of Shelby where I attended high school. When he wasn't on his ranch, my grandfather built and managed a geology camp in the Beartooth foothills, where Ivy League professors brought their students for summer courses and projects. I learned a lot about science from the students and faculty at that camp. In my junior year of high school, I completed a geological map of an oil-producing anticline in northern Wyoming that got me invited to the Westinghouse Science Talent Search in Washington, D.C. It was the first time I'd left Montana, and I went by myself on the Great Northern Railway. I was awed by the brilliant students I met in the capital and returned to Montana determined to join their ranks. My father worked for Mountain States Bell, managing the construction of a series of communication microwave repeater stations across the state. He was a superb engineer, and he taught week-long summer courses to his employees in general aspects of electrical engineering. He encouraged me to take these courses, mostly, I think, so he could show me off to his employees. I participated with reluctance, as I would rather have been out hiking and mountaineering. In retrospect, these courses changed my life. They taught me to think about biology in terms of engineering systems and circuits, a concept that was later very useful for my commitment to developing new technologies for biology and the new discipline of systems biology. Shelby High School had only 146 students, but it had just about everything any other school might offer. I played oboe in the school band and was co-editor of the yearbook. I acted in plays and traveled the state as part of the debate team. I served in student government and played quarterback on a football team that was undefeated for 2.5 years. And I was blessed with some of the best teachers I would ever have. They treated me as a colleague and broadened my intellectual horizons. They challenged me to think about science as a career with a sophistication I never would have achieved alone. My most formative experience was helping my chemistry teacher, Clifford Olson, teach a sophomore biology class. I taught directly from articles out of Scientific American, and in the spring of 1956, I taught a lesson I developed from an article on the structure of DNA, only 3 years after it was discovered by James Watson, Francis Crick, Maurice Wilkins, and Rosalind Franklin. I didn't understand much about it, but the idea that the core of biology was centered around this beautiful molecule fascinated me then as it does to this day. DNA intrigued me for another reason. My brother Glenn, who was 6 years younger than me, was born with Down syndrome. And when I learned about DNA, I wondered if it might play a role in his condition. My father and mother were split on how best to care for him. There was a state home for children with Down syndrome in Boulder, a good 4 hours away in central Montana. That's where Dad thought Glenn would get the best care. Mom wanted her boy to be at home. Dad, as usual, won the argument, and it was probably the right decision. Glenn flourished, and in his teen years moved to Hardin, Montana, where he spent the rest of his life. Glenn went on to own his own home and hold 3 jobs simultaneously for much of his adult life. I respected my brother and desperately wanted to understand Down syndrome. I remember asking our physician and my parents about the cause of Glenn's condition. No one had an answer, and I was always fascinated by questions without answers. The genetic cause of Down syndrome, a duplication of all or a portion of chromosome 21, was finally discovered in 1959. By that time, I was at the California Institute of Technology, Caltech, following my mentor, Mr. Olson, who had attended university there during World War II as a Navy meteorologist. He was so impressed with the school, he had vowed to send any good science student he had there. At Caltech, I was surrounded by outstanding students, many of whom were already quite a bit further along in their math and science than I was. I had to work hard to catch up. Caltech gave me a superb technical education in math, chemistry, and physics. My professors included Linus Pauling, the only man ever to win 2 unshared Nobel Prizes, and Richard Feynman, another Nobel Prize winner, whose work was foundational to quantum mechanics. Both were excellent and inspiring teachers. My biology training was exceptional too, but it focused almost entirely on microbes, plants, and viruses. I was passionately interested in human biology and disease, and decided to go to medical school in the hope of later doing research in human biology. At Johns Hopkins Medical School in Baltimore, I became transfixed with molecular immunology and the question of how our immune systems could protect us against so many different types of pathogens. One approach to this problem was to study the structure of antibody molecules, a major component of the human immune response. I decided to pursue my PhD in this field, returning to Caltech, so that I could work under William Bill Dreyer, who had made fascinating discoveries in this area of science. Dreyer was an unusual biologist because he had a deep interest in technology. He gave me two dicta that have guided me ever since. 1. If you want to practice biology, practice it at the leading edge. And 2. If you want to transform a field, invent a new technology to interrogate it. The Vietnam War dictated the next phase of my life. As an MD, I had two choices. I could join the military or serve in the public health service. I chose the latter and was assigned to the National Institutes of Health, NIH, where I met many young scientists who would become leaders in the field of medicine over the next 50 years. I also learned to manage my own laboratory. But mostly I decided what I wanted to do in the next stage of my career: study human biology and disease. And so it was that I headed back across the country to Caltech, where, in 1970, I became an assistant professor in biology. I had decided to focus on two areas of research. The first was molecular immunology, a leading-edge topic area in biology at that time. It was the complexity of this field, which deals with disease responses mediated at the DNA level, that so intrigued me. All those challenging questions without answers embedded in the complexity of human biology. But I immediately saw a problem. We didn't have the tools to approach many of these questions. In my emerging view, biology was an information science. Without ways of measuring this information, we were lost. This led me to my second focus, the development of new technologies to assess the four major types of biological information: DNA, RNA, proteins, and biological networks, per Bill Dreyer's second dictum, previously stated, which identifies technological innovation as the path to transformative research. Medicine in those days, and even today, was very much like the parable of the elephant and the six blind men. In this ancient Buddhist story, each man feels a different part of the elephant and comes to a completely different conclusion about what the animal is based on what he has felt. The man who grabs the trunk believes he is touching a snake, while the one who grabs a leg thinks he is touching a tree trunk. Limited by the symptoms of illness, physicians were like the blind men. I came to several conclusions in my time at Caltech. First, I felt it was important to generate lots of data on each individual, for buried in the data were the keys to deciphering human complexity. Second, I became convinced that blood was a window into viewing wellness and disease, because it bathes all organs and receives protein signals from each organ that can reflect the internal health state of that organ. In principle, the wellness to disease states of all organs can be assessed from blood. It wasn't until recently that we had the tools to start doing this and understand all that we could learn. Moreover, at the time of my studies, we didn't have the language to convey the complexity of all this biological information, or understand how to think about it. We weren't just blind, we were speechless too. Later, systems biology gave us a language for beginning to decipher human complexity. Around the time I was coming to these realizations in the early 1970s, I read The Structure of Scientific Revolutions by Thomas Kuhn, which described paradigm changes in physics. These shifts, revolutionary new ways of thinking about or practicing a discipline, are difficult to conceptualize and even harder to achieve. That's because discoveries that come to be recognized as paradigm-shifting moments almost always face staunch resistance initially. Scientists, like the rest of us, are generally reluctant to give up long-held beliefs and accept new ideas. In spite of the resistance, or perhaps because of it, I have been fortunate to have been involved in a number of paradigm-shifting moments in my career, changes in biology, medicine, and technology that we now see as revolutionary. In homage to my boyhood home, I've come to think of these as big sky moments. They led me to a new approach to biology, founded on the realization that humans employ complex biological systems to carry out the normal functions of the body, and that focusing on any one of them to the exclusion of the others will not get us very far. Bringing engineering to biology. 20 years after the discovery that DNA molecules exist in the form of a three-dimensional double-stranded helix, a finding that gave us the conceptual insights we needed to understand what our genome does, we still didn't have effective tools to explore this code. DNA is a digital code with a four-letter alphabet, the bases G, C, T, and A. By the time I started teaching at Caltech, we knew that DNA was the source code of all life, and we were beginning to use this nascent realization to better understand how humans develop from a single fertilized egg into an adult human. For this to happen, all 20,000 units of DNA encoded in our genes have to be copied into another four-letter language, messenger RNA or mRNA. These single-stranded molecules are then translated into the 20-letter amino acid language of proteins, the functional machines of life, and a key part of the biological networks through which our bodies operate. Since the information they carry is encoded in submunits in DNA, RNA, or proteins, one must be able to determine the order of these nucleic acid bases and characterize the order of amino acids in a protein to understand the nature of this linear information. This is what we now call sequencing. Per Edman, a brilliant Swedish biochemist, found a way to sequence proteins in the 1940s. He was the first person to build an automated sequencer, which sped up the process considerably. His tools and methods, however, required lots of proteins and could not generate long sequence reads. When I returned to Caltech, sequencing remained a long and labor-intensive process. Since my initial training was in protein chemistry, I thought I might be able to develop an instrument that could sequence proteins more efficiently, offering longer sequence reads with far less starting material. If I could achieve this, proteins available in very small quantities could then be characterized, their genes cloned and sequenced, and, hopefully, their missions discovered. This was not simply a challenge of biology, but also one of chemistry and engineering. There was a lot of pushback to such cross-disciplinary work in those days. For some biologists, it was anathema. In 1973, Caltech's chairman of biology, Robert Sinsheimer, came into my office and asked me to give up on the technology development. "Your field is molecular immunology," he reminded me. "That's where your focus should be." I told him I wouldn't be altering my goals and waited to see what the fallout might be. Sinsheimer later told me he was delivering the message on behalf of the school's senior biology professors, who felt it was inappropriate for me to practice engineering in a biology department. If that was my focus, they had suggested, I should be moved to the engineering department. To his credit, Sinsheimer never sought to have me transferred. The resistance didn't just come from Caltech. When I sought support for my team's automated DNA sequencer from the National Institutes of Health, my first two grant applications received priority scores that were among the worst I would ever get. The reviewers offered comments like, "This approach is impossible," or "Graduate students can easily do all of the sequencing needed." They seemed to have little appreciation for the exponentially increasing amount of sequencing that would soon be the bedrock of so much biological and medical research, and even less for how talented graduate students could most effectively use their time. I wish I could say only a few outliers held this view. I remember talking with Jim Watson, the co-discoverer of the structure of DNA, in the mid-1980s about automated DNA sequencing. "Why are you putting so much time and resources into this project?" he asked me. I tried my best to explain, convinced that automated DNA sequencing would transform biology. But I don't think I succeeded. "Just remember," he said sarcastically, "that there are 1 billion people in China, and if each one of them sequenced just 3 bases of the human genome, it would be finished." My initial efforts were only marginally successful. And there were times when I thought the naysayers might be right. But in the mid-1970s, a brilliant chemist and engineer, Michael Hunkepiller, joined my lab. We collaborated with Bill Dreyer, my former PhD mentor, to develop an idea that Dreyer had conceived for protein sequencing, a liquid gas phase instrument. This approach eventually led to a technology that could create long sequence reads with 200 times less protein than previously required. Over the next 25 years, my collaborators and I worked across disciplinary boundaries to develop 6 different instruments to analyze and synthesize DNA and proteins in various ways. These included automated DNA and protein sequencers, automated DNA and peptide synthesizers, the very large-scale inkjet-based DNA synthesis technology, and the single RNA molecule nanostring analysis technology. The automated DNA sequencing instrument approach employed 4 different fluorescent dyes, one for each DNA letter, with a synthesis sequencing technique that allowed us to visualize each base in a DNA sequence. We were able to convert the order of colors obtained by laser scanning into the sequence of the DNA fragment by a computational transformation. The 4-color DNA sequencing chemistry we developed at Caltech has been the cornerstone of automated DNA sequencing for the past 35 years. At last, we could read this sacred text, the code of life, and we had the combined forces of molecular biology, chemistry, engineering, and computer science to thank. The Human Genome Project. Now that we had the tools to sequence DNA more efficiently, we could focus on a previously impossible goal: determining the order of the 4 nucleotide bases of a DNA strand in each of the 23 pairs of human chromosomes, what came to be known as the sequence of the genome. This was a daunting task, as about 3 billion DNA letters make up the human genome, and chromosomes range in size from about 50 million to 175 million base pairs. This was not a mountain to climb just for the sake of being the first. For decades, scientists had been dreaming of what they might learn if DNA were ever to become more easily readable. Once the order of bases in the human genome was determined, many believed we would have the information we needed to begin to understand how different genes are expressed in different tissues, to understand why a liver cell is different from a brain cell, and so forth. There was also a widespread hope that one could correlate defective genes with different disease states and better understand the mechanisms of disease so that we could develop targeted therapies to deal with them more effectively. Writing in the journal Science in 1986, Renato Dulbecco of Caltech suggested that sequencing the human genome might be the key to understanding cancer. All of this was easier to dream about than to accomplish. While I was initially skeptical, I was intrigued enough to attend the first meeting on the Human Genome Project in the spring of 1985 on California's Central Coast, where Robert Sinsheimer had become chancellor at the University of California, Santa Cruz. Sinsheimer had invited 12 experts in genetics, human biology, and technology to assess the merits of an effort to sequence the human genome in its entirety for the first time. Bart Barrell and John Sulston, both biologists, had flown from Cambridge, England, and visionary biotechnologist Hans Lerach had traveled from Heidelberg, Germany. The Massachusetts delegation included the biologist David Botstein, biochemist and physicist Walter Gilbert, and Leonard Lerman, a geneticist. Helen Donis Keller, whose company, Collaborative Research, was working to produce one of the first linkage maps of the human genome, was also in attendance. David Schwartz, a chemist and geneticist, had arrived from Columbia University. The shortest trips were made by the California contingent, which included George Church, a now famous geneticist who was then at the University of California, San Francisco, Ronald Davis, a biochemist from Stanford, Michael Waterman, a biologist and mathematician from the University of Southern California, and me. Together, we debated the merits of attempting such a feat. Even with an early-stage automated DNA sequencer, we agreed it would be extremely challenging and tremendously expensive. We were split 6-6 on whether it was a good idea. One major objection was that the project represented big science, and there was a fear, not unreasonable, that it could steal resources away from the more targeted biological research that was then the cornerstone of biology. No final decision was made in those 3 days, but the excitement was palpable, and those of us who were most in favor of the project began crafting plans to build support. As I went out into the scientific community to talk about the project, I found that some 80% of the biologists I spoke to were opposed to the idea. So were leaders from the National Institutes of Health. That's right, the NIH, the largest funder of biological research in the United States, wasn't supportive of funding the Human Genome Project at first. The sources of resistance were broad in scope: technological, social, ethical, legal, organizational, economic, and political. I remember giving a Friday night lecture at the Marine Biological Laboratory at Woods Hole, Massachusetts, in 1986. These lectures, which date back to the 1890s, are famous as sounding boards for new ideas in science. The hall was filled, and I was initially satisfied that I had made a sound case for the Human Genome Project, and for using the power of automation to make it happen. This impression did not last long. "You say automate this and automate that," a prominent colleague offered at the onset of the time reserved for questions. I ask you, where is the humanity in your science? I was taken aback. I had thought it was obvious that automation would bring humanity back into science by freeing researchers from needlessly mundane tasks. Maybe I thought this critic was just an outlier, but the reactions actually went downhill from there. I had arrived in Woods Hole just before the lecture. My host, caught up in the hostility, went off with others after the lecture and left me alone with my thoughts and my luggage. This was in the days before Google could point you in the right direction, and I had to ask a janitor where my hotel might be. Over the next few years, as funding opened up and institutional support solidified, most of us working on the Human Genome Project heard from many scientists who expressed concerns similar to those I'd heard in Santa Cruz, worrying that this enormous project would take resources away from smaller research efforts. And to be fair, there was no lack of important small science research being done at that time, with a senior scientist and perhaps a handful of colleagues focused on a single gene or protein. I wanted them to think about what they could accomplish with an entire genome, but instead they were focused on what they could accomplish with the sort of money we would need to complete that genome sequence. The project might never have gotten past this resistance had it not been for a seemingly unlikely source of support: the U.S. Department of Energy, DOE. In the wake of the development of the atomic bomb, the DOE had directed some of its research efforts to understanding the ways in which radiation causes genetic damage. Without an entire human genome, argued visionary Charles DeLisi, who was then the director of the department's health and environmental research programs, it would be impossible to answer such questions. The DOE's initial funding supported the development of key technologies needed to begin the Human Genome Project. I had thought that powerful ideas would open minds to the opportunities inherent in the project. In fact, it was the tools that swayed most scientists. As the physicist Freeman Dyson would later write in Imagined Worlds, new directions in science are launched by new tools, much more often than by new concepts. The effect of a concept-driven revolution is to explain old things in new ways. The effect of a tool-driven revolution is to discover new things that have to be explained. Still, the big science versus small science debate was a tremendous hurdle. It was U.S. Senator Pete Domenici and his colleagues who helped us see this as a political challenge and conquer it as such. The Republican from New Mexico initially supported the Genome Project because it would benefit the two large national laboratories in his state, Los Alamos and Sandia. Later, he advocated for the project based on the idea that it would give the entire nation a competitive edge in biotechnology. The key to gaining broad support, Domenici recognized, was to go after new money, so that small science advocates couldn't argue that resources were being taken from them. By the late 1980s, there had been a dramatic shift in excitement for the Genome Project. Perhaps the most determinative issue was the fact that a National Academy of Sciences committee, initially including advocates and opponents, wrote a report unanimously backing it. NIH soon jumped in with enthusiasm and money. That was important, because our initial prediction that the project would be expensive was correct. All told, it cost about $3 billion to produce the first human genome sequence. In 2013, the Battelle Memorial Institute estimated that our initial investment of $3 billion had delivered more than $800 billion to the U.S. economy, a return on investment previously unparalleled in biology. Some argued at the time that this was a poor way to gauge success, saying that the true return on investment could only be measured in health outcomes. But either way, in my view, this was money well spent. Determining the sequence of the human genome gave biologists access to human genetic variability. And that, in turn, offered us the ability to do something that could never have been done before. We could begin to correlate the variations in our genes with health and disease outcomes. Human genome sequencing was originally overhyped, leading to disappointment in the speed of its translation to medicine. Still, the project transformed many different fields in biology, and I believe the most important human health returns are only just now beginning to be realized. Cross-disciplinary biology. If the idea of biologists and engineers joining forces created a storm of controversy, what came next was a veritable typhoon. As my lab evolved to handle the complexity of developing multiple types of instruments, it became increasingly necessary to interface with an even broader set of scientists with diverse skills. To create leading-edge biological technology, you had to gather under one roof all the different specializations required for a wide range of highly complex technical projects beyond biologists. Chemists, computer scientists, engineers, mathematicians, physicists, and physicians. You had to put them in proximity to one another and create the conditions for serendipitous interaction. You had to teach them how to understand one another's languages. And you had to treat them the way a good football coach treats a team, respectful of each person's contribution to the whole, and mindful that everyone is an expert on their own position. It is teams like this that are now driving the development of groundbreaking technologies and the creation of multi-layered visualization, measurement, and computational tools capable of analyzing big data. These teams are poised to revolutionize medicine by generating tools that are capable of seeing new dimensions of biological data, enabling biologists to formulate new hypotheses about human health and disease. The development of sequencing tools would not have been possible without teams like this. Across the scientific world, agile minds were thinking alike. In 1987, the National Science Foundation launched its Science and Technology Centers program, an initiative aimed at tackling big science problems through the recruitment and integration of scientists and engineers. I applied for a grant to create one of its first programs. We called it Molecular Biotechnology. It was the most effective grant I ever received from the federal government, in that much of the money was discretionary and available to catalyze immediately new opportunities. Microsoft founder Bill Gates, who was then and is now a tremendously generous supporter of innovations that can improve human lives, was an early believer in cross-disciplinary work like this. He played a vital role in helping me realize my vision for building such teams. Disheartened by the frequent lack of support from senior colleagues at Caltech, I had been contemplating whether my work might be a better fit in another place. In 1992, Gates made it possible for me to start the first academic research unit in the nation dedicated to cross-disciplinary health science research and development at the University of Washington, UW, Medical School. The new department came to be named Molecular Biotechnology. The provost at Caltech was bewildered when he learned of my intention to move. "Lee," he told me, "you should go see a psychiatrist. No rational person would leave Caltech for the UW." That sort of academic arrogance was off-putting. I didn't care about status. I wanted to work in an environment where scientists were enthusiastic about what we could be doing together. If you look at a health science journal from decades ago, you might notice that most articles had one, two, perhaps a few authors. That's not just because senior investigators used to be quite a bit more selective when it came to sharing credit. It's also because in the days of less complex tools and fewer measurements, the breadth of knowledge required to conduct experiments was smaller. Not so long ago, a single person could advance an entire field based on what they saw under a microscope in a petri dish. For many areas of biology, those days were long gone by the time the first human genome was sequenced, although there is always room for brilliant, single, individual ideas. These days, health science articles authored by only one or two people are rare. It takes teams working across disciplines to integrate and analyze diverse types of information to do science that moves the needle. Today, advances in medicine often take systems of people working together as part of an interconnected network. A new way of thinking about and practicing biology is taking shape. The rise of systems biology. Despite the tremendous advances that gene and protein sequencing offered us, most of the research world was still locked in classically reductionist research. We studied biological systems one gene at a time, one protein at a time, one disease symptom at a time, ignoring the ever-mounting evidence that there are very few processes in our bodies in which A causes B and B causes C and so on, in a simple, linear manner. Rather, an increase in A might start a chain reaction in which we see a decrease in B, which prompts a switch between C and D. D, however, is consumed by A, causing A to plummet, but when B rises as a result, C and D cannot switch back, because D has been used up by A. All of this is to say that biology generally operates as complex systems rather than linear pathways. We may have identified most of the 20,000 or so genes in the human genome, but we are still working hard to understand what they do individually and, more important, how they operate in networks where one component of the network may influence many others. We are only just beginning to assemble genes and their proteins into biological networks for regulating the expression of genes, metabolism, and the functions of protein networks. We are barely able to understand the dynamics of these systems, but that doesn't change the fact that, without a systems approach to biology, we are helpless when it comes to truly understanding any biological process. A useful analogy for understanding systems biology, one that we have borrowed from Yuri Lezebnik, is to think about how one might go about figuring out how a radio works. One could break down the radio into its component parts and study what each one does individually. This is essentially what biologists were doing before the advent of systems biology, studying the individual components of life, genes, proteins, or metabolites, the key components of our metabolism, one or a few at a time. That's a good start, but the parts of a radio don't work independently from one another. Most of them don't do much unless they are connected to other parts. A systems approach to understanding the radio would require 1. Defining the parts, 2. Connecting the components to their wiring circuits, 3. Carrying out experiments to understand what the individual circuits in the radio do, and 4. Understanding how all these circuits come together to create the different functions of the radio. In a similar manner, scientists engaged in systems biology conduct experiments to determine how each part of the human body is connected to other parts and to the whole. This includes, for instance, investigating how genes and the proteins they encode are joined into biological networks, considering what the functions of the individual networks are, and examining how the various networks are interconnected. We do this through experiments that determine the operational dynamics of the systems in an effort to understand how they give rise to disease. I wanted to build a systems biology center on top of a cross-disciplinary framework at the University of Washington. Alas, the bureaucracy of a large state university made it a challenging task. When I asked for space for the growing computer needs of my department, the head of university computing informed me that a janitor's closet was all the room a biology department would ever need for computing. He failed to understand that biology was an informational science with exponentially increasing computational needs. Later, I persuaded a prominent cell surface chemist from Pennsylvania State University to join my faculty, but the dean informed me that cell surface chemistry was an inappropriate subject matter for a medical school faculty member. When I sought to use the Gates Endowment to bring this brilliant scientist to my department, I was overruled. It wasn't all frustration. Just as I had been able to blossom as a researcher at Caltech, the University of Washington was a tremendous venue for trying out new ideas. Ultimately, though, if you are someone who is used to pushing the envelope, you're liable to push it further than the bureaucracy of a large state university will permit. So I eventually concluded that if I wanted to create a systems biology institute, I would have to start my own. In 2000, I left the University of Washington to start the Institute for Systems Biology, ISB, an independent nonprofit research institute that was the first of its kind. Systems biology represented a holistic and integrated approach to biology and medicine. At ISB, we built a framework for the cross-disciplinary approach we created at the University of Washington, adding to it a dynamic vision of biology as an intricate web of processes that impacts and energizes whole biological systems. Our work challenged some of the very foundations of biological research, raising concerns about what happens when you take cells out of the body to examine them in test tubes or petri dishes. We found that removing cells from their natural environment often changes their behaviors in fundamental ways. You can imagine how well this went over with researchers who had spent their entire careers working on studies that began by looking at a part of something instead of the whole. I remember talking with one of my friends at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, around the time we started ISB. He was brutally frank in his assessment of this new systems approach. "It is all hype," he told me. "It will come to nothing." I suspect by hype, he meant that large global approaches were approximate, error-prone, and unlikely to yield any fundamental insights. This has not turned out to be the case. Indeed, today there are more than 100 systems biology institutes, departments, and centers across the world. And these institutions are tackling biological and medical questions that previously couldn't even have been asked. Among our early successes, we learned how galactose metabolism, which delivers energy to the body and is key to early human development, functions in yeast. And we used this process as a demonstration for the fundamental approach of systems biology. Our work on galactose enabled us to determine how the different elements, nodes, in the metabolic network influenced one another, giving us an integrated view of how humans metabolize and use galactose, a form of lactose, to store energy as adenosine triphosphate, or ATP. This advance gave us an early indication of how potentially powerful the system's approach to biology could be, offering the promise that it might help us understand complex aspects of human physiology, and raise the possibility that we might even be able to tinker with it to optimize its functioning. We developed a model, published in Cell in 2007, that made it possible to accurately predict the behavior of a simple microorganism, a halobacterium that lives in high saline conditions, given knowledge of its biological networks and outside signals. Our model gave us key insights into the symbiosis of different life forms and their environments. We even managed to predict the halobacterium's responses to environmental signals that it had never seen before. It was a modest beginning leading to a future where deep insights might be gained from the perturbations of human biological networks. We learned how the brain's transcriptional networks change during the initiation and progression of a neurodegenerative disease induced by prions in mice, commonly known in humans as mad cow disease. The most fundamental insight that came from this study, which we published in 2009, was a realization that disease is very simple at its inception, and that disease-perturbed biological networks become increasingly complex, mitigating against the likelihood of successful late treatment by any single drug. Almost 10 years after the conversation in which my colleague from MIT tried to warn me away from the hype of systems biology, he co-authored a National Academy of Sciences report in which he described the biology of the future, essentially as systems biology. He is not the only one to have changed his tune. These days, when scientists are asked to speak about the future of biological research, they generally point to a future that is holistic, data-intense, integrative, dynamic, and network-based. All systems approaches. The simple idea driving this progress is that changes in mRNA, proteins, metabolites, lipids, and other small molecules can be traced back to the physiological networks that control them, and that these can give us vital insights into human biology and disease. A demand for personalized medicine. As we applied systems thinking to the challenge of moving our science from the lab to the clinic, one thing became very clear. You cannot hope to understand a biological system that is chaotically broken through disease if you do not understand its normal operational state. This means you cannot hope to understand a state of disease if you don't understand a state of wellness. Once we started investigating the wellness side of the human health equation, we began to fundamentally alter the way we viewed medicine. Why should medicine be all about fighting disease? Why shouldn't it, first and foremost, be about keeping people well? We can and should battle diseases when they happen. This fact is not debatable. But increasingly, it is becoming clear that we have the tools and knowledge to optimize wellness and keep disease from happening in the first place. But we just aren't using them effectively. This realization, together with systems thinking, led me to the conceptualization of P4 medicine. Healthcare that is predictive, preventative, personalized, and participatory. The marketing gurus at Healthcare Inc. love all of these words. Alas, truth is no prerequisite to branding. That's especially the case when it comes to personalized medicine, which has been widely adopted as an advertising slogan, but is rarely embraced as an effective practice. Large healthcare systems tell their customers they'll treat them as individuals, but that's not what most patients experience. But it is unquestionably what people want. The past 20 years have seen a notable shift for many patients from large-scale health providers to caregivers who practice what is often called complementary and alternative medicine. In some cases, these providers offer well-researched practices like correcting measured blood deficiencies in vitamins or nutrients, for example, iron, omega-3 fatty acids, or vitamin D or B12 deficiencies with clinical consequences. But they also can address emerging areas of health, like the gut microbiome, that simply have not yet been integrated into mainstream care. Some physicians have begun to recommend alternative services to patients who have not found healing for their chronic illnesses through conventional medicine. In many situations, however, these alternatives are nothing less than outright quackery, with the best-case scenario being a placebo effect, and the more common experience leading to no improvement or a decline in patient health. When mainstream doctors tried to understand what drives so many patients to try alternative medicine, we often tell ourselves that desperate people do desperate things. I believe that this is only a small part of the answer. The bigger force at play is each patient's desire for care that feels it is actually meant for them as an individual. And despite the valid criticisms of some purveyors of alternative medicine, this personalized and wellness-focused experience is what patients feel they are finally receiving when they move away from the dehumanizing experience of robot-facilitated customer support lines, packed waiting rooms, insurance-dictated treatment regimens, and doctors who are in and out of their lives in minutes and prescribing medicine by the playbook while paying little attention to the patient's individual condition. We see the scientific wellness revolution as delivering the kind of care people clearly want, predicated by the deep scientific evidence base they deserve. So why can't conventional care providers walk the talk when it comes to personalized care, winning back these patients who are so anxious to be treated as individuals? Simply put, it is because arriving at care that is truly personalized, but also scientifically validated, requires a data-driven systems approach to wellness. It takes medicine that is predictive and preventative, which, as we will discuss, is only possible with a vast array of measurements, assessing many of the hundreds of biological networks functioning within the body, to identify what wellness is uniquely for each person. That baseline is essential if we are to determine what the early stages of a transition to disease might look like in an individual. To get there, we need to know each person's genome, analyze their ever-changing phenome, and take into account relatively continuous measures of digital health. Only then will we have the depths of data needed to predict and prevent disease through interventions targeted at the earliest detectable transitory phase. And that, as you can imagine, isn't going to be cheap. Not yet, anyway. We'll return to this. The health maintenance organizations that provide the overwhelming bulk of patient care right now would rather talk about personalized care in their marketing campaigns than do the work that actually makes these words a truthful representation of what is happening in their clinics and hospitals. After all, truly predictive, preventative, personalized, and participatory medicine would incur most of the costs well ahead of the time, when the bills are traditionally paid. That is, after the transition to disease has already occurred. The resistance to this idea feels like an echo of what I heard when I first sought to convince biologists of the importance of the Human Genome Project. But our vision was realized then, and I believe the same will come about for P4 medicine. Indeed, it is already happening. My colleagues and I have offered personalized care of the kind I am describing for thousands of individuals, and as we shall soon see, it works beautifully. That's one of the key reasons I believe this is a paradigm shift that, while by no means complete, is already taking place. Indeed, there are several programs, including NIH's Million Person All of Us study, Singapore's Million Person Project, and the UK's Our Future Health Project, which includes 5 million people, that are beginning the research necessary for data-driven health. Later in this book, we will discuss how you can join this process over the next 5 to 10 years. It should be pointed out that the first 3 P's of P4 medicine, prediction, prevention, and personalization, are driven by science, whereas the 4th P, participatory, is a psychological, sociological, and economic challenge. How do we persuade patients, physicians, healthcare leaders, regulators, and all members of the healthcare ecosystem to participate in a paradigm change that will be the largest ever in medicine? The 4th P is far and away the biggest challenge for 21st century medicine. Now you now know a great deal of my story. I am a biologist, entrepreneur, and inventor whose automated DNA sequencer was the enabling technology for the Human Genome Project. To some, I am better known as the champion of P4 medicine and founder of proteomics and systems biology. But throughout all of these years and innovations, I was never acting alone. I owe a lot to the fantastic people who have worked in my lab over the years and to many collaborators around the world. In 2005, 5 years after founding the Institute for Systems Biology, I was approached by a talented young bioengineer, Nathan Price, who was just finishing his doctoral work with Professor Bernhard Paulsen at University of California, San Diego, the world's leading expert on modeling metabolism at what we call the genome scale. Nathan's story. Nathan Price, who is almost 40 years my junior, is an expert on the intersection of big data with biology and medicine. As a graduate student, he built computer models of the vast repertoire of biochemistry in living systems, in an effort to answer questions like, how does your body convert the food you eat into energy and all the components needed for your body to function? These were heady times. The human genome and other genomes had been sequenced, and it was possible for the first time to build comprehensive maps of biochemistry, with a catalog of how many enzyme-encoding genes there actually were. Nathan thrived in Paulsen's lab, where he felt he could wake up every morning and ask, "What is the most valuable thing I can do today to advance science?" and dedicate the rest of his day to doing that very thing. Paulsen told me Nathan had published the most peer-reviewed papers in the history of the department and, quite unusually, he had already accepted an offer during his final year of graduate school to start his lab in chemical and biomolecular engineering at University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, one of the top 10 departments in the country. But first, he wanted to learn more about systems biology and P4 medicine, and that drew him to visit me in Seattle. It wasn't long before he was contributing in important ways to our work at the Institute for Systems Biology. He identified new diagnostic biomarkers for distinguishing cancer types and guiding therapy choice, and invented methods for systems biology data analysis. After 2 years at ISB, Nathan started his own lab at University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. His lab centered on systems biology, and this core expertise gave him a chance to connect with scientists working across a wide range of fields. He led the computational analysis on projects in genetics and social behavior with Gene Robinson, the complex dynamics of biological systems with Nigel Goldenfeld and Carl Woese, metabolic engineering with Huimin Zhao and Hans Blaschek, and the biology of methanogens and their role in climate change with Bill Metcalf and Zan Luthi Schulten. Although his focus was on personalized medicine and synthetic biology, he also worked with researchers engineering microorganisms for energy-sustainable projects. The University of Illinois is one of the great research universities in our country, with a first-rate engineering school and a storied legacy of 30 Nobel laureates. But Nathan came to believe that if he really wanted to play a role in shaping the future of medicine, he needed to move to the center of the action, and that led him back to ISB. During his time at Illinois, we stayed in close contact and collaborated on a number of projects in systems medicine. In 2 years, we developed diagnostic markers for cancers, analyzed disease-perturbed networks, and invented a number of computational tools to make these things possible. We committed to a biweekly call on Tuesdays at 6 a.m., wherever I happened to be in the world, and we spent a week together each summer at my retreat in Montana, where we would talk science, plan the future, and hike in the mountains. In 2011, I convinced Nathan to move his lab of more than 20 graduate students and postdocs to ISB. It wasn't long before he was a full professor and associate director of ISB. With the move, he was able to focus all his efforts on his main interests, systems medicine, and increasingly, the development of scientific wellness. Nathan had come to believe that we almost always wait to deal with disease until it's far too late. Even when someone proactively goes to their doctor with early warning signals, a typical response is come back once you've had this terrible symptom, and at that point you'll get a drug to help you manage that symptom. We all know someone who has had an experience like this, but Nathan had also had friends who were able to dramatically improve the quality of their lives by getting more information about what was going on in their bodies and by taking action to alter the course of their health. He came to believe we could do much better, and that it was vital that we move beyond disease-focused healthcare to a more active managing of wellness. Nathan and I started talking about what more could be done to optimize wellness and began exploring ways science and technology could drive better outcomes and allow people to take more control of their own health. In time, as we spoke and collaborated, we became convinced of the need to gather dense data over long periods of time, beginning with healthy people, something that was clearly lacking in contemporary healthcare. This was a passion we shared, and we loved working together, so we partnered on this effort in earnest in 2013. And by 2018, I convinced Nathan we could best move our vision forward by merging our two lab groups to form the Hood Price Integrated Lab in Systems Biomedicine. In 2016, Nathan received the Grace A. Goldsmith Award, given to one researcher each year under the age of 50, for his work pioneering scientific wellness. 3 years later, he was named one of 10 emerging leaders in health and medicine by the National Academy of Medicine. In 2020, when he poured himself into understanding the effects of the microbiome on human aging, he received a Catalyst Award in Healthy Longevity from the National Academy of Medicine. And in 2021, he was appointed as one of 18 members of the influential Board on Life Sciences for the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine. In the fall of 2020, as the coronavirus pandemic was still raging and Pfizer announced the success of the world's first mRNA vaccine, Nathan became CEO of Longevity, a health artificial intelligence startup, and, following a merger and IPO, chief scientific officer of Thorn Health Tech, which is dedicated to bringing much of this vision of scientific wellness into practice.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.